Good evening, everyone. We are happy to have our CMA lecture series today and welcome you all. So first lecture talk is going to be by Jabir Kharaj. A brief introduction of what Jabir. Jabir was born in a small village called the Pudupadi in Kerala, which is about 45 kilometers from Kozhikode. He grew up as an ordinary boy and finished high school at the government school. And he got a scholarship to go to Delhi and studied at the Zakir Hussain Delhi College. He decided to study history, and then that was when his life took an interesting turn. After graduation, Jabir did MA in the same subject from Delhi University. Jabir wanted to do something more actionable, and it is around this time that he was selected for the Gandhi Fellowship. And he credits this two-year residential program for changing his entire life. After spending 7 years away from his hometown, he was ready to come back to Kerala and start a social enterprise. Jabir was in search of a sustainable business idea and decided to focus on the burgeoning problem of waste management. In order to get a firm grip on the subject, Jabir went to Coimbatore for 3 months and trained under Velur Srinivasan, project director of Indian Green Service, a solid and liquid resource management company, and worked as a rag picker. Jabir took the challenge of starting a new business, Green Worms, in the small town of Thamarasheri in Kozhikode district. Let's hear from Jabir Kharaj, the founder of Green Worms Waste Management, social entrepreneur, garbologist, climate change warrior, and many more. Jabir Kharaj, the man on a mission to change Kerala's waste. Over to you, Jabir.
Thank you, sir, for the humble introduction. And thanks, CMA, for giving me this opportunity. So let me just briefly tell you what I'm trying to do in Kerala through my enterprise called Green Worms, which I call it as a social enterprise, because it's a culmination of, it's a business as well as solving a social problem. Can you just enable my screen sharing as well?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So we try to do, a couple of things. We could try to solve a couple of things or be part of the solution, not as a solve completely. One is divert the waste, especially municipal waste, from landfills or oceans or incinerators specifically. Can you see my screen? Can you see
yes,
my Javi. Screen?
Okay. Yes, Javi.
Okay.
Make it on slideshow mode. Perfect.
Yeah, we tried to solve a couple of problems. One is how do we divert the waste from landfills or oceans or incinerators? So we realized that, or the basic study which I done that realized that 95% of the so-called waste or garbage, it can be, reused or reprocessed, or can be added to some value added, it can be used for some value added purpose. So that's the whole idea of, why should we send this material? Only 3-5% of material we should send to a landfill or, we need to incinerate it. Other 95% of the so-called, which we usually throw away from our households or commercial establishment, can be reused. There is a purpose. So that's the first thing which we try to do through a lot of recovery activities. Second, we also realize that, maybe if you're able to, if you can recover around 2 metric tons of waste per day, that can create a job for, around 20 women, especially 20 people. It can be right from collection, transportation, and further processing. It's a huge employment opportunity, lies in this waste management sector. So specifically a dignified employment opportunity, creation. That's the second thing we try to do with enterprise. The third thing is, so we come up with a concept called plastic credits, like a carbon credits, where the model where we work, it's a platform where waste generators, the end users, as well as the brand owners, over whom we can buy and sell the credits. So like a carbon credits model, that's one of our major business we do. So we do have, so that's the third things we do. And fourth things, of course, like all other sectors, how do we integrate technology, both software as well as hardware, you know, in order to reduce the cost or increase the operation efficiency, as well as increase the scaling up, you know, capability. So that's what the four things which we try to do in this sector. So it's very simple, you know, it's not a rocket science, or, you know, I'm not an inventor or anything. I just do very simple activities because, as I said, basically, you know, to recover this 90% of the waste from landfills or anything, it's just right from, you know, it's some proper methods needs to be done, you know, right from households. We do, you know, this is a basic process we do. And it's not very mechanized and all. It's very simple, common sense things. And we manage this whole value chain, you know. So right now we started collection from door-to-door collections and all. So now we have around 22 villages and 4 municipalities in Kerala. And outside Kerala, around we have 6 EOLPs. So we just simply facilitate this whole aspects, collection, transportation, you know, segregation, and we don't use any end products from it. Rather, we channelize to end users or end users for this material. We realize that that's the major problem. There are a lot of, suppose if you give water bottles, if you maybe 1,000 tons, metric tons per day, there is a user for that. But they need only water bottles that's all white or green. So there are certain standards the end user are looking for. That's what we facilitate. It's in terms of the quantity, you know, we started with, you know, 100 tons per year in 2014-15, and this is a 1-year-old data. So last financial year, we have completed 14,000 metric tons, you know, especially from Kerala. So so especially those material which otherwise would have ended up in landfill or oceans. So this is a kind of a composition of the data. Major percentage, especially plastics and especially footwear, cloth and bags, those kinds of materials forms a larger percentage. So for the last 5 years, we have been growing in terms of 100%. You know, we have been able to increase our collection, you know, recovery efficiency as well as the business turnover. So just a quick numbers in terms of, again, you know, we operate in other than Kerala, we operate in, who needs material from ocean plastics, you know, who needs material, who needs some plastic waste, which would have, you know, like it's called ocean bound plastic, certified plastics. So we work in Andaman, Lakshadweep and Kerala, and we do work in some Godavari, Kostinandra as well. And so far we are employing 420 people in the last, this year, in this month itself, you know, we have launched around 5 projects. So as I said, it's a huge employment opportunity through a small enterprise. And so in terms of very interesting things, it's out of these 14,000 metric tons last, you know, which we did last year. So we have done a business of around 80 million, you know, rupees. So that's the, you know, that's the kind of business worth which we're able to, you know, generate from the waste itself. See, how do we make money in terms of, so we have a couple of business models, like municipalities, we work with hotel apartments, hotel industries, you know, like Aster Group, many other such leading groups in the states, you know, our clients. So we give them a responsible waste disposal services with all the legal compliances, like municipality and all, we charge a nominal fee from the Aster, you know, to manage the waste. Other than this private and commercial establishments, we work with municipalities, villages, and even Clean Kerala company as their waste disposal partner. That's the one source of revenue. Like we charge a waste disposal fee from these people as a management fee from these people. Second is, as I said, around 70% material has got some value. 25% material goes for energy recovery in cement kiln. It's called refuse derived fuel. They shred these plastics and use its calorific value and use it as an alternative to, you know, coal. So around 70% cement people don't pay me anything, but, you know, 70% material, I can able to, you know, derive some value, though the recovery cost is high. So I sell this recyclable material to end users like reusers, you know, like recyclers or pyrolysis plants and various people. And I make some revenue. The third things which I do, that's one of my major business, I sell plastic credits. So whatever the plastics which generates from the waste streams, you know, like I work with Hindustan Unilever, Dabur, Godrej, ITC, and more than 10 clients. I have Indian clients as well as I have two. One is a German client, otherwise a US client. So where they do have some legal obligations, some others for a plastic neutral company, like a carbon neutral company, a plastics neutral company. So I sell this material, like I sell the credits, that's one of our major revenue. So this is something innovative, you know, in terms of plastic credits, though people are doing in other ways. I'm the first person from Kerala who is actually doing these plastic credits business specifically. And other than that, we do a lot of awareness programs, of course, awareness programs and other little, free campaigns and all in various parts of the states. We are young people in terms of a team. So mostly it's below 30 years or 35 years of age. And so that's something, which distinguishes us. We keep learning and innovating on a daily basis. We don't see, like everything is in new things. And so these are simple things. So what I am trying to do now, I'm trying to integrate technology in terms of we used to do segregation manually. Now we are integrating technology, like conveyor belt, metallic, separators, ballistic separators, automatic sensing sorters and all. And as well as we have come up with a mobile application, from especially door-to-door mobile applications, to increase the efficiency of door-to-door collections and especially increase the traceability and transparency of the whole value chain. That's something we do. And something challenges what we currently face actually in Kerala specifically. Actually, we don't have the ownership. Though we wanted to, as I said, we were able to do only 14,000 metric tons of waste in the last financial year. So we had the capacity, we had the money, but we are, there are a lot of policy restrictions. Like I had to stop a lot of projects in Calicut Corporation because people said, I'm not, only Kudumbashree can collect the waste, only municipality can collect the waste, a private entrepreneur cannot collect the waste. So there's a lot of policy and such level restrictions which stops the, especially private entrepreneurs, so that's the, I'm also, I got some seed funding as well. I'm a bit skeptical to invest in Kerala because I'm not sure whether I will get the waste material or not. So so that's the one challenge. Second thing is just that it's really difficult to like a small entrepreneur like us, it's difficult to go to a municipal corporation and ULPs. It's easy to work with small villages and all, but big corporations needs 100 crore, 300 crore projects. They don't want simple solutions, they don't want smaller entrepreneurs. So it's very difficult to work with officials, government officials, as well as the political, politicians. That's something, which I'm struggling to scale up this volume. That's it, Ajay's basic introduction. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Jabir. Thank you very much. Interesting thought and idea, what you're trying to do with primarily looking at eco-friendly e-governance and the waste management, which is primarily a biggest challenge right now in the entire universe, I would say, not in Kerala as well. So I think we can take a couple of questions before we start. Captain, is that fine?
Yeah, okay, go ahead. I'm just waiting for the mayor.
Okay. Any questions? Anybody wants to ask a question? Yes, Adin, sir.
Yeah, Jabir, good to know about plastic credit. Jabir, how is this plastic credit quantified? And is it a price that is fluctuating, or is it driven by market pricing, or does the multinationals will be in need of these credits and they pay you more on this?
Sir, plastic credits, Indian brands pay very, very cheap. They just need the quantity. But internationally, European clients and US clients, they pay really better. But there are certain standards like a social auditing, third party, auditing standards, which we need to do. So, of course, it's a market driven approach, not any fixed approach. And of course, when you work with European clients, there is a higher, you know, like 4 to 5 times better price you get. But there are certain, you know, of course, that their standard is a little higher in terms of social compliance. It's called that way. A third party has to do it. Quantifying, so there is a process of documentation, especially in India, there is a central pollution control board norms, how to collect, transport. So there are certain verification, like traceability documents we need to provide. So a third party will inspect, I get a 50% once I complete the quantity, then 50% I will get after a third party does auditing. So there is a certain documentation challenge, you know, and of course in terms metric tons, the volume is being done in metric tons.
How you generate this credit?
Yeah, simply, you know, suppose in Calicut Corporation, if I collect maybe 100 metric tons, I need to transport, you know, I'll have to provide certain credits means I will have to actually collect the material and dispose it properly. Suppose, you know, I have to make sure that it has collected from so and so place and has, you know, disposed in a cement kiln, maybe for an energy recovery. So if I provide this kind of documents, so that's the credits. You know, I love to back, you know, give supporting documents that, you know, so and so quantity I have collected on behalf of that certain company. So that's how we do.
Who will certify this?
So there is a third party, there is a third party auditing company who does these things. There is a, for international customers, there is a standard for plastic standard. For Indian clients, of course, there is only the central pollution control board norms only. But internationally, there is like a carbon credit. There are certain certifying organization.
Good. Do you sell in the international market also?
Yeah, yeah. Because that's something advantage for me. That's why I operate in Lakshadweep and Andaman and all. So there is a higher price for ocean-bound plastics credits. Because we live in a coastal area. Like ocean-bound plastics are any plastics within rates within 45 kilometers. So for me, it's okay. Almost in Kerala and all the places I'm eligible for, you know, to get this ocean-bound plastic credits. So that's why I operate in islands and coastal areas now. I focus.
Great to know, Jabir. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ajayan, sir. Any other questions from the audience? Please, you can unmute and ask a question to Jabir. Okay, so my question to Jabir, specifically from Kozhikode, right? Being we are in Kozhikode, what is the type of changes? You know, did you try doing it in Kozhikode? And you know, was it a success? You said that, you know, corporation, dealing with corporation and the entire end-to-end chain from a Kozhikode perspective. So any success story or any type of incident that you want to share that you've taken care here?
Sir, I tried to do many things in Calicut corporations. I was succeeded in terms of working with the private establishments. Like Aster MIMS, actually, it's, you know, it's 5 years they are taking our service. ICRA Hospital, you know, there are a couple of hospital groups, especially private establishments. At the same time, you know, this Taj groups, Ravi's group and all, Kudumbashri people stopped me taking, you know, they threatened me, they harassed me. You know, they said, though the customers wanted our service, you know, the government, the Kudumbashri and the local officials came to me and said, you know, I cannot operate, only the Kudumbashri can collect the waste. So of course, there are some good experience from Calicut and some bad experience too. And they kind of moved out. It's a little difficult to work with bigger corporations, you know. They don't listen to you, you know, as I said, you know, they want pretty big projects, they want fancy things. Or you have to be, you know, in terms of bit more nepotistic and all. It's very difficult to work with bigger corporations. I moved out of in Kozhikode district. I'm doing a very interesting projects in Thamarasheri, Omasheri, Thiruvambadi, you know, a lot of other interior places. So I had some good experience and bad experience. What private establishments are doing, really, you know, I'm very happy working with private establishments specifically.
How about you working with directly with RWAs? You know, so do you work with RWAs or there also you
we
have
used
a
to. We used to work with. Now I am not able to. I cannot go and do the collection from households. So I used to work with more than 112 plus RWAs in Calicut. Now Kudumbashri or the local officials said I cannot work with because it's their waste. So I cannot go and collect the waste. So it RWA project was very, you know, it was very, very interesting project. I mean, it's very useful projects, very cost efficient. It called, we used to do a lot of community collection. They used to arrange it internally and all. Now we stopped all those things. You know, it has been 2 years now. But yeah.
Okay. Great. Good to know that.
Just to know what is the price of carbon plastic credit now, just to know how it fluctuates, just to know if you can tell us, just to know.
It varies from, 5 rupees to 25 rupees. That's the per kg price, per kg.
Can't you source it from Kudumbasri? Let them collect it, but can't you source it?
Yeah, I'm doing it, sir. That's how my major things I'm doing it. But their operation is little so that if I source the material from their facility, maybe I can load maybe, you know, 3-4 tons in a truck. But it goes from my facility, I can load the same truck more than 10 tons. So the kind of efficiency in terms of packing and other things are also a challenge for me. So that, you know, I do source from a lot of private organizations from Kerala.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Jawar. Is it just plastic credit? Is it something related with the carbon credit, or can we use it? Can we trade it or something?
See, the final international standard is yet to be, you know, on a final stage. It's simply, you know, it's called plastic neutral. Suppose, you know, ITC company has, you know, it's multi-layer plastic, some specific grades of plastics. Then if they send it in Kerala, this is statewide targets. So there will be maybe 500 tons every month. So we just need to collect this and dispose it properly, either recycling process or a waste energy process. Then the documents will be given to them, you know. Yeah, it's mostly a paper trading stuff. The way it has evolved for carbon credits, it's yet a lot of people are working on it, but it's not that stage now. But like carbon neutral, the plastic neutral is going to be, you know, it's emerging, you know, business opportunity to this coming years.
Any other questions? Anybody wants to get more knowledge from Jabir while he's available with us? Now, Jabir, let me ask another. What is your vision, right? So, for example, now we are seeing a year-on-year growth, which is 100%+ here on where in terms of the garbage collection. So, what is your vision? What is that dream that you have? You know, like, you know, you said that the mission is to make Kerala waste free, but then Kerala, you are not successful.
So 30% of managing 30% of Kerala waste is the targets down 7 years down the line, building a business of 100 crore, you know, per year on a turnover. So that's a 7 years plan, you know, which we are. So this year we'll be doing 15 crore. So we have certain, you know, as of now, it's going as per the track, unless government supports, because since a lot of intervention, you know, it's still a government issue, you know, waste is under their control. You know, even somebody wants to give a waste to me, they cannot simply give it to me. So
Jagat, you're there? I think there is some sort of a network issue there. President, any update? Jabir, you're back?
Yes, sir. Okay. Did you hear me?
Sorry. We lost here towards the end. So.
Yeah. I said 30% of waste, 2,000 jobs. Okay. That's the thing. So we are at 400 now.
Wonderful. Wish you all the best. Good luck. And we hope that you meet your aspirations, right?
Anil, I'll just give a presidential address and we'll go for the second session. Mayor is there in another meeting. Once we finish up, she will join. We will continue with the second session now.
Okay, so give me a minute, Captain.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you very much, Jabir. Please continue on the session. We will have one more entrepreneur, you know, Sandeep. Again, a different story that, you know, is good for us to listen. And then our honorable guest, Mayor of Kozhikode, Dr. Bina Philip, is going to be there as a part of chief guest. To give a brief about CMA. CMA is one of the most vibrant LMA, which is affiliated to All India Management Association, New Delhi. And set up in 1986, is a body of management experts, professional managers, entrepreneurs, businessmen, and academics interested in promoting the cause of professional management. CMA has won several recognitions from IMA, the latest being the winner at the national level for the Best Local Management Association Award for 2018-19 for its outstanding work in spreading management thought in the region. There are several icons who have addressed CMA in the course of many programs over the years. And CMA has been focusing on entrepreneurship and the professional management ecosystem in Malabar. CMA has been regularly organizing thought-provoking programs, capacity-building workshops, lecture sessions, and providing platforms for discussion, debate, and learning for management practitioners, in addition to our monthly meetings like this. Numerous programs are also being organized in partnership with Kerala Startup Mission, a Government of Kerala initiative, Chamber of Commerce, educational institutions like IIM Kozhikode, Calicut University, NIT Kozhikode, government bodies like Kerala Small Scale Industry Association, and many associations. And with that, I would invite President Captain K.K. Haridas to welcome the gathering and deliver the presidential address. Over to you, Captain.
Thank you, Anil. We are expecting our chief's best for the day, Honorable Mayor Bina Philip. She is now attending an urgent official meeting. Speakers of the day, Sri Sandeep Dandashiri and Sri Jabir Karat, respected past presidents, office bearers, invited guests, CM members and family. Wish you all a warm good evening. On behalf of Calicut Management Association, I welcome you all for this monthly speaker meet. Today's our lecture session topic is energy and environment management. The first session on sustainable and scientific waste management was conducted by Sri Jabir Karat, who is the founder and CEO of Green Worms Eco Solutions. He is very much familiar with most of the resident associations of Kozhikode. He is taking care of the garbage management of ship visiting at Bepu Port also. And he has conducted a very good session and have a very good ideas in future also to conduct. And thank you, Jabir, for your session. The second session will be conducted by Sri Sandeep Dandashiri, who is also well-known among mariners and engineers. The first solar boat, Aditya, his brainchild, for which he got the international recognition. He'll be talking on the renewable energy on marine transport. The entire world is working on alternate energy source from the existing fossil fuels. Solar energy is one among the main alternates. In today's Hindu newspaper, I read a report on a new development by a professor of Agriculture University, Pukod, Wayanad. He developed a technology to generate biodiesel from the chicken waste. Let us hear more solar energy by Sandeep. Thank you. Good day.
Thank you, Captain. So I think we will go ahead with our second speaker for the evening. A brief introduction of Sandeep. Sandeep Dandashiri, an entrepreneur based out of Kochi with interest in naval architecture, technology, and solving real problems. He's the founder of and CEO of Navagati Marine, Naval Solar and Electric Boats, and Xship Analytics. An ambitious marine transport solution provider with an aim to help save fuel and money using better design, renewable energy, and analytics. Sandeep is an engineering graduate, naval architecture from IIT Madras. He worked 2 years in the Alcock Ashton shipyard and 5 years in the best shipyards in South Korea and Japan before taking up entrepreneurial route in establishing distinct companies. He has a dream of transforming marine transport the way Tesla has done in roads. Nevalt is a pioneer in solar-powered electric boats after the launch of India's first zero-emission ferry, Aditya, in 2017. Nevalt offers solution from zero-emission to hybrid technology vessels in sea or inland waters. He is the author of the book Solar Electric Boats that was released this month, and the ebook is available in Apple iBook and Amazon Kindle, while the print edition would be ready soon. Let's hear from Sandeep, a passionate personality and a well-known in the Indian as well as Kerala ecosystem. Over to you, Sandeep.
Yeah, thank you. So shall I share my screen here? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I have the physical. So all of you can see my screen, I hope. Yeah. So good evening, everyone. And I'm here to talk about application of renewable energy in marine transport and some of our experience and our plans. Now, before we start, we should think why we need renewable energy. That's the first question we all must have an answer to. One of the first things which comes to our mind when we think renewable energy is the impact on climate change and the positive benefit it provides in reducing it. We must think of the scale of impact when we talk of any of the solutions. That is the first step we should do. So this is what 2016 on the percentage on contribution from each sector. In this, you can see that transportation is about 15.9%. Of which shipping, which includes both inland and seagoing, is about 1.7%. Although the percentage is small, from an impact perspective, is almost 2 gigatons of CO2 per year. So that's where we are trying to address. Now, for this session, I'm trying to, when I share the numbers to help people understand, I'm just trying to take three categories of boats in terms of sizes. One is a small boat, 10 passenger. Then there's a medium size 30 passenger, and there's a large ferry. And the ferry usually means something which runs almost every day in a year, where the left extreme are the leisure boats, which run about 250 days in a year. So that's the operational categorization. Now, from an emission perspective, when we talk of this kinds of boat, a small boat says about 20 tons of CO2 per year. And the large ferry like Aditya is 100 tons of CO2. Emission saved per year, plus the other SOx, NOx, and what is shown on the right side are those numbers. This gives a sense of what is the impact on one such boat, right? So this helps us decide how many we need and et cetera, how we can get a benefit. Apart from emissions, then there is impact on the water. As you can see, most of them pump dirty, the diesel ones pump dirty bilges and unburned fuel. None of these are there in solar boats. So that's a clear advantage of shifting to renewable energy. When we talk of renewable energy, it is important to mention the life cycle assessment. There is whenever I give a session, a question comes out is, we all know that solar saves CO2. But what is the carbon required to produce one? So at least that is in the minds of all people. So the number I have put is for that purpose, like 1 kilowatt of solar needs about 2 tons of CO2. And similarly for a battery, 1 kg of the battery needs about 13.5 kg of CO2 for production purpose. So if you translate that into these three boats, like for example, the ferry, the total panel plus battery contribution is about 50 tons. If you see the earlier, compare with the earlier number, that is less than half a year of emission saving. So what the quantum is, the amount of energy needed to produce such renewable solution can be offset in less than 1 year in terms of saving. That's a key message which we all should remember in terms of the numbers. And then the other reason is, of course, comfort perspective, which is no noise, no vibration, no smell of fuel. These are the other reasons why you should shift to a renewable solution. Here again, a critical element is an OPEX number. So here I put the number of a large ferry like Aditya. So this is in US dollar, but it is, if you convert, it's about 30 lakhs per year versus about 50, 60,000 per year. So that's a quantum difference in OPEX between a solar ferry and a diesel ferry. So that's the OPEX difference. As you know, OPEX is crucial in public transport. OPEX is more important rather than CAPEX. And this is across the type of boats. All the three boats, you see that huge difference between a solar ferry and a diesel ferry. This is driven mainly because OPEX is driven by energy cost, which is very low in the solar electric boats, etc., renewable solutions. And that is what drives this. And in why I said about the public transport example is their CAPEX may be funded, but OPEX, if you cannot manage your OPEX, you are bleeding. You know about KSRTC, and today you know about Kochi Metro also. Kochi Metro bleeds about 350 crores per year. So that they cannot manage even the OPEX. It's a difficulty if you can manage OPEX. CAPEX, you can always say it's an infrastructure investment and all that reasons, but OPEX, you need to manage. Then for mainly for the private investors, you need to know the life cycle cost or the total cost of ownership. So this is on the left side is a large solar ferry, and on the right side, left side is a large diesel ferry, and the right side is a solar ferry. You can see that although the initial cost is about 20% more, life cycle cost is less than half. So that's the savings in, and this is not just, and that's about less than 3 year break even period. This gives an idea that how effective is the solution, especially public transport. And the numbers are similar in other sectors also. The smaller boat, etc. All these have the life cycle cost is significant difference is there. Now, another important thing for a country like India is the impact on foreign exchange. What are we saving in foreign exchange by avoiding fuel import versus the foreign exchange you lose by importing lithium cells and solar cells, right? Which also comes outside India. So this is the net saving in a life cycle of 20 years. It's almost 1 million, which is about 7.5 crore in terms of a large ferry versus smaller ferries, 1/10. But net, there is a huge net savings in foreign exchange. This is another reason why government should really push for a renewable solution. Now, this safety element is nothing to do with solar or being renewable, but it's just a focus on a safer boat, which is more possible when you invest in a modern solution rather than a very traditional approach. Because in India and in this region, when you design a boat for 75 passengers, you must assume that 200 people will be on the boat. This is a very common sense in India. But invariably, when you design a boat right for 75 or maximum 10% margin, in an unlikely scenario, which has happened almost every month, you will have an incident in rest of the country. Kerala, the last one was in Thekkady. Yeah, there was one afterwards. There was more of a collision, but Thekkady is a classic case where the stability margins are being low. So this is a crucial element. So invariably, we try to say, take the margins higher, and then you do a catamaran, much more margin of stability. The simple logic is as much people who can stand on a boat, which means if you have a 1 meter square, you have 4 people you can stand. That much capacity you should take, because on a festival day, like in Vaikyam, in our boat, almost 200 people enter the boat. But we know that up to 250, it is safe. We know that. I mean, that's the maximum they can squeeze in. But I'm just saying that kind of thinking is needed. Again, I just want to just quickly talk about the philosophy. Solar boat manufacturing design is totally different from a diesel boat. You need to be very conscious of the approach in your design. So the contribution of these three, which is either from the sun, the grid, and genset or fuels or all, any other sources, this has to be thought through and designed right at the beginning. One important philosophical approach is how can you reduce the weight of the boat significantly, right? By using lighter materials or optimizing a structure and removing unwanted things from the boat. For example, if you are taking a boat, which is a ride is 15 minutes across the river, you don't want toilet on the boat. You should have toilet on the jetty. So many unwanted things should be out of the boat. So this is exactly what we did when we set out from a typical ferry, which is 35 ton. To Aditya, which is half the weight, 17 tons. So this is what we could do. The other thing is a lot to do with the design which is like whether it should be monohull, multi-hull means catamaran, then whether it should be slender and longer, or whether it's a round shape and few other design techniques to reduce the resistance. So much so that instead of needing 50 kilowatt power to run, taking 75 people, we need 15. And that's a crucial step before we can talk solar, which means that a typical wooden boat, what you see on the left, you cannot put solar panel on top and put electric motors and batteries. It will not be economical. You can achieve a technology solution, but the batteries will be way bigger than what the economics will allow you. The other element is, where should you put the solar? Whether it should be on the boat or on the shore. Now, there are two reasons why we put on the boat. One is to get cheap energy on the boat for the usage, but that you can get cheap energy on the shore also. But the bigger reason is, by putting on the boat, when the boat is moving, you get the energy. That means you can reduce your battery size. And that's a significant reason, important reason why we should put solar panel on the boat, which unfortunately Kochi Metro has gone on a different direction for some strange reason. But anyway, that is up to them. But if you talk a boat as electric, it automatically means maximum solar on the boat. But then of course you do the whole production side, storage side and consumption side efficiency improvement. Like from our Aditya version 1, when we are doing Aditya version 2, which will come in another 2 months. So that has a difference of about 20% efficiency improvement, which we have done over the year. So we hope that by the time somebody else come with seeing our Aditya 1, we would have already launched a 20% better boat. Something which is important from system-wise safety is all these safety levels, right? You have, first is complete redundancy. So you have two systems on our boat, which is electrically not connected. So which means, even if you have a failure in one, it doesn't affect the other side. This is very important. Again, there is a tendency, like Kochi Metro tender, there's an interconnection between the two, which is not a great idea. But typically, keep it independent so that there's a complete redundancy, have a lot of levels of safety, whether it's slowdown safety level, etc. So you have a lot of monitoring, which is not there in any normal ferries. Something about technology, I want to say that, of course, the speed power relationship, speed is a crucial element for energy. The weight you carry is important, and the distance you want to travel, or range, like what you talk of EVs. But the most important is the speed. That is explained in this figure. So from a speed of 6 knots, which is on the left extreme, 6 knots means about 11.5 kilometers per hour. You need 16 kilowatt. You move to 12 knots, which is almost 22 kilometers per hour. It is 190 kilowatt. It's more than 10 times by just doubling the speed. It is that sensitive. So, which means the energy required for the same distance might be 6 times. So you have to consciously choose a speed as much as what you need. And then around 8 knots is a margin where you go from a zero emission to a hybrid. This is not a hard and fast boundary, but more or less this boundary holds good for all practical purposes. And then just to give you an idea of types of systems, you have a serial hybrid or a parallel hybrid. And serial means your engine is connected to motor and motor to propeller, which means the engine is never directly to the propeller. That's a serial hybrid. And parallel means engine also to propeller, motor also to propeller. So this is the difference. And depending on the application, we choose one of these and optimize the system size. I'm not going into details of system, but the important thing I want to tell you is you can either make it independent system, or if you want to connect, you can connect in the AC side or on the DC side. There are two ways to do it. And usually common AC is on the large ships. Common DC on the large ships, like Queen Mary is an electric system. On a large ship is common DC. Smaller ships are common AC. And here I just want to give you a sense of from our thinking, as far as we are thinking, battery chemistry is a crucial element. So there are a lot of chemistries, NMC, NCA, LCA, LMO, etc. So this is an example where an NMC is a nail penetration. So you can see that chemistry itself is unsafe. You can lead to a lot of explosion. And there have been many accidents in the marine industry with NMC. So we totally avoid NMC. We use either LFP or LTO. Both are very safe chemistries. Auto industry do not use this because of the weight factor. But in a boat, the battery weight is not a significant factor like auto, like cars. So that's why Tesla and all use NCA, which is inherently very unsafe chemistry. But they add a lot of electronics, liquid cooling, and a few other things to make it safer. But in an accident, things may not go the way we plan. So that is why we avoid it entirely. Then the motors could be inside the boat or outside, what we call as outboard motors with pot. These are some thoughts, but I want to just touch base on the fuel cell, which is another way of trying to solve the issue of the range issue in a battery, for example. But here, the technology is there. If somebody tells us that, can you do a fuel cell boat in Kerala tomorrow? We can do it. So the issue is constrained with the economics of the fuel. As in the hydrogen fuel, today it's coming at around $15-16 per kg. If it is in and around $3 to $5, then the economics will start working. So Indian Oil is on record saying that the green hydrogen, they will start providing at $2, which if it comes, it's fantastic. The hydrogen fuel vehicles will take off. So the constraints imposed by the speed and the range will totally disappear. It will behave just like a diesel boat in terms of that. Here again, it's I don't want to go into details of battery sizing, but just want to give you some insight that when we design the battery, we have to solar boat, we try to see how the production is there the whole year. The top left graph shows how the production for a per kilowatt is for the whole year. And the land-based average is about four and a half per kilowatt in Kerala, for example. And in the boat, it's about 3.5 because you're making it almost flat. So this distribution, you try to plot in an increasing order in the below chart. So you see the graph peaking suddenly in the first 30, 40 days. And then there is a natural slope, slow slope. So this, why you do this is to decide for what condition of solar you should design your system. If you think that I must design my boat with zero sun, then it's practically like an electric boat. So you are then the battery size is as much as what you need for the day. For example, in this case, if you need 90 units of energy in a day, your battery size is almost 120, which is on the shown on the right side graph. There's a curve for the battery size as it gradually drops down, right? This is how you size a battery for what days you want to cover. So a smart person will try to size it, cover most of the days, and then leave the last 10-20% days so that can be covered by slight change in operation efficiencies or adding a small genset as backup. If you do that, the battery size can be significantly different. So you know that in engineering, if you want to cover 100% scenario, it's totally different from you want to cover 95% scenario. And that 5% you do with in a different way. So this is the best way to optimize a system in engineering. And that is exactly what we do in boats. We don't size the battery for the worst condition. We size the battery for almost all the condition and have an alternate mechanism for the worst condition. So this is how the battery production, the energy usage is in a day. In a day operation, again, you have to see in a day to optimize the system, right? You see how the battery level drops, how the solar contributes, and the motor consumption, right? So this you check whether the battery level drops in some time. So this is just a quick video on the boat, just in case somebody has not seen the boat. I don't know if there is somebody who's not aware of the boat. So this has been an operational from 2017 Jan 12. So this was a video was made by Brutt when we won the Gustav Award for the world's best electric ferry last year, right? So in the 4 year anniversary, I mean, which was Jan of this year, almost 13.5 lakh passengers traveled. And from the graph you see from the right side, about 80,000 kilometers it is traveled, right? So, and the savings on CO2, etc. is there. So this is how the boat itself is operating in Vaikyam, Kavanakadava route. And there you also see the diesel boat next to it. So this is the boat system. These are the motors. These are inboard motors. So this is a comparison from 8,000 versus about 180. This is for Aditya. That's a difference in OPEX. So this is a Gustav award I just mentioned for the world's best electric fitting. Anyway, so I'll move on. So there are a lot of applications which is possible today because one, the battery prices have dropped. And two, the solar panel prices also have dropped. The more contribution is from the battery. Plus, we also have achieved some level of economies. Like a few years back, we are doing one ferry. Today, we are building 20. So, and we hope to do much more in the coming years. So that economies have helped us also. But it's mostly market driven on the lithium pricing. So on the left side are the water taxi, ferry boat, leisure boat, all this we have done. The cruise boat is the one which is coming in 2 months. Fishing boat we are doing with Shell Foundation, 5 boats we are making. By October, we will have those 5 boats so that we give it as a demo boat to the fishermen to help those small fishermen, 10 meter fishing boats, which there are 2.5 lakh fishing boats in India. Ro-Ro ferry will come in Kerala in a year time probably. Harbor boat we are making for Mazagon Dock, Mumbai. And Navy, we are working on the petrol boats. Other area is even on the large ships. Why not on the large ships? So solar can also provide an impact on the large ships in their electrical requirements. So it's also a very economic decision in a large ships. This also we are doing a project for MSE. Wind is another fantastic use on the large commercial ships. So when we think wind, we think large sails with huge footprint. But today, when we talk wind on vessel, it is either the skysail or these kind, either rotating. The approach we are taking are these suction sails, where you have an aerofoil-shaped structure, which gives that lift, which means the forward movement thrust. And then there is a suction pump to prevent the separation. So this is only the design element is completed. We hope to do a smaller prototypes on the vessels, on a smaller vessels. Before going into larger ships. Larger ships is a huge, it's a multi-million dollar investment on each ships, which we can't do on a prototype level. So we want to establish on a smaller vessel first and then convince for the bigger one. So just to give you a sense of what is happening in the world in terms of electric boat. This is just the electric boat size, which is estimated by Veracious Statistics. It's about $14.3 billion, mostly in Europe. There is some level happening in India, but mostly it's Europe. But now there are a lot of other markets around India, which we are talking and also people are entering that space. From a policy level, almost always electric boats are totally ignored by government. The FAME scheme, the FAME 1 came earlier and the FAME 2 came last year, nothing on electric boats. It's a constant struggle for us to convince the government to think electric boat. Almost every state do not even talk of electric boat. Kerala is one exception who have at least mentioned in the state policy that electric boats, etc. But the main incentive is driven by central government. Today, it's totally ignored. We hope that will change. And another thing which is applicable across the marine industry is what is the financing. So if you go want to buy a car, you put 10%, 20% down payment, the rest 80, 90% is financed without any collateral. In car, it's an automatically you do that. And that's one of the reason why the numbers of auto industry, automobiles have picked up in the recent years or the last 10 years. In boats, you need a different collateral. The banking industry people will understand. You need a collateral on top of the boat to get that financing, which is very strange. That's due to one act called Surfacey Act, which is under consideration to be amended to add airlines and marine industry. I hope that happens. So as far as we are concerned, we are working on all the kind of various solutions in marine transport to transform it the way Tesla has done on roads. In whatever we have gained in our experience in the last 10 years on solar boats, at least I've tried to capture in this book, which was previously mentioned. We just launched it on 4 days back on the birthday of Nikola Tesla. So we hope many of the readers will find this useful, and I'm willing to take questions. Thank you.
Hi, Sandeep. Thanks a lot. Fantastic. We heard you about 5 years back in IIM Kozhikode, and this is after a long period. There's a lot of growth that's happened within Novalt. Great to see you back. One of the questions from our ex-managing director of Milma, Vijay Kumaran, sir. What is, in your opinion, why inland waterways across Kerala is not getting momentum? So many technologies are available, and again, we are going planning for high-speed rail connectivity in Kerala, where it seems to be, you know, the waterways having high, more of high benefits than the railways. So what is your opinion and take on that?
So why inland waterways is not picking up is a question of a chicken and egg situation. In the sense, inland waterways, for instance, have created a lot of fantastic berthing facilities in various locations, especially cargo side. But then the assets has to be there. Unless the boats start plying, they will not deepen. They will not deepen, and the fishing nets also will not go. So which comes first? The infra comes or the boats come? So naturally, some element push has to come from the government, from cargo, which the Water Transport Department is increasing the number of boats on the long distance. There are a lot of projects announced by the government, which will come in the next 1-2 years. I know a few announcements which will come, and tendering and all is happening for cargo and passenger movement by the government itself. That will motivate more private bodies to start moving in into that space on the longer distance. You referred for the comparison high speed, so it's a longer distance travel. For shorter distance across, there are so many solutions. Like in Kerala, where the backwaters is 3 to 5 kilometers wide, you cannot put bridge every 50 kilometers. A bridge is 1,000 crore investment. You cannot put it every 5 kilometers. You can put every 50 kilometers or 100 kilometers, which is why you have one or two bridges across Vembanad, for example. It's very expensive. So instead of putting 1,000 crore, you put 100 crore, you have so many assets on a region. I mean, ro-ro ferries, boats, etc. Not even 100. You may need about less than 30, 40 crores only for typical location. On a big location, maybe 100. So this is a direction. Kerala government recognizes it. They have some 7 boats, 6 of which we are building, coming up this year. They are coming up with another 10 more boats in the next year. So they are going very strong on solar electric, and they realize the benefit of it from seeing Aditya's. So once the government shows a direction, it is the private people who have to start moving, which again, we now most of our, or at least half of our new orders are private, which are all these resort owners or individuals who are moving, taking that switch. So we believe that the electric vehicle industry have started showing the direction, and that similar thing is happening in the boating sector. Overall, as a society, we don't enter the water except for livelihood. So that may change. It's a cultural change that may change. Then more private and leisure boats will come. Otherwise, it's a public transport will come with the government drive, is what I feel. So I'm very optimistic in the coming years.
Thanks, Sandeep. So this doesn't come under Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, right? It comes under which department in the government?
In the central center?
Yes.
Shipping, yeah. Ministry of Shipping.
Okay.
So it's now Sarbanand Singh Sonowal. Yeah, he's a minister now.
Okay, great. If it would have been Nitin Gadkari ji, so probably would have got more traction there. Probably he's more passionate about conventional energy, getting out of
I don't agree at all, because Nitin Gadkari was the minister before in the first term. So his focus was there in overall port and shipping, but that was more towards the port infrastructure. He's an infra man. He likes the port and infra, whereas shipping and boat are mostly private driven, right? As far as central government is concerned, there are a few states like Kerala, West Bengal, Assam, Goa and all, where it's government driven, but that's state government driven. So that might be the reason why they have didn't do, even when he was the driving Minister of Shipping, with his image, he should have done, but he has not done. That's a fact. So
is it because that inland waterways doesn't have a sort of a policy at a national level, or is it purely driven by state level policies?
The application of boats and all, there are a lot of state element to it, especially transport from a passenger perspective. Cargo is completely private driven. So that's one of the reasons why they don't do the same way. They don't think the same way as highways, right? In the, on the roads, it's again private transport, right? Cars, buses, private dominant. But the roads is still government. They are putting money. The equivalent in water is inland waterway maintenance. But beyond a point, they don't want to pump money because there is no movement, right? So that's what I meant by the chicken and egg situation, right? So the government has to do some work together between state and center. At least Kerala has already shown what can be done in the electric space, and many other states are now learning to do so. In that, that seems to be the issue why the central policies are, they're not even talking of electric boats, central government. I mean, that's also reason because Delhi, when you sit, the Babus or the ministers sitting in Delhi, they have no clue on the what water transport is because Delhi has nothing, right? Unless somebody who understands, like somebody from Kerala is there, West Bengal, Assam, Goa, or Maharashtra sits there. Now, thankfully, Assam chief minister, previous chief minister is now in the shipping ministry. So he might, he understands the importance. So probably it may change, is my feeling, but let's see.
Great. So our president is Captain K.K. Harida. So he would like to ask a question. Over to you, Captain.
Yeah, Sandeep, I'm a master mariner sailing for the last 40 years. And then for the last coastal passenger ships, I'm there for the last 20 years. Okay. And I'm operating this KSANC on the ferry boats from Beppu. First of all, Kerala government do not have a proper plan and department allotment. Port department is allotted to one minister, and inland waterway is allotted to chief minister. Inland transport is with somebody else, and there is no coordination and there is no vision. Mm-hmm. Even Kerala Shipping and Inland Navigation Corporation itself going for the other diesel engine vehicles. These two boats are lying idle for the last 3 years. Other than me, nobody could even operate. This is the Volvo engines, quite expensive, highly consuming fuels. That's one of the reasons. Even we try for a solar boat or thing, there is no financial support we are getting from anybody. And government do not have any policy also. Especially when you come to the Malabar region, there is no inland waterways policy at all. The moment you start from the Beppu port itself, within 2 kilometers, they have very low level bridges. So you can't operate your boats. That is all the thing. There is no vision and planning that we generally experience. I think you should, we are also trying, you also put some sort of teaching to them what is the waterways and how to develop it, mainly for the passenger traffic and the cargo also.
So, and in North, just tell you, there is currently, discussion or deliberation happening on the inland water transport constrained by the bridges.
Yeah.
So what you know that at one time when there was a huge shift from inland to roads, people started building bridges without thinking whether we will need to go underneath. There are many locations which are spoiling the water transportation by building bridges, even national waterway potential type area. So there is an identification of the bridges. I know for Kollam to, I'm Kottapuram to Kollam, all that bottlenecks are being discussed and removed. I attended a couple of meetings in the last few months. That's why I'm saying. But from Kottapuram to Kozhikode, Beppu and all that, to supposedly to Kasaragod, which the CIL is trying to do, that would be the second phase probably. But there is some movement. But yeah, of course, the crying baby finally gets milk. So obviously, we all have to cry more harder to get something is what I feel. Yeah, but they realize it, but whether they will do it is the second part of it. Yeah. We should work together on this.
Sandeep, can you exit out of the screen share if you don't mind?
Sure. Sorry.
So I will, thank you.
Can you tell me how much will be costing an 100 to 150 passenger boat if you go for a solar one?
So when you say 100 to 150, it's just seating ferry?
Yeah, seating ferry.
So the 100 passenger air-conditioned seated ferry, which is coming out in double-decker, which is coming, the one I said 2 months later, no, it's coming. Yeah. That would cost almost 4 crore. 100 passenger, air-conditioned, completely solar-powered, is almost 4 crore. If you do hybrid, you can probably reduce slightly, but Yeah, this is roughly for 100 passenger. 150 also doesn't matter. It's the passenger, it's not very sensitive. Between 100 to 150, we may cost slightly more only. Its crucial decision is what speed you want to go and how long you have to design for running.
This, are you talking about the catamarans or single hull ones?
Catamaran.
Is it possible to get consistent single hull vessel? We can't go for a double decker mainly in the, we want to use it for mainly in Malabar and all. We have to cross seas to connect from river to river. At least 10 kilometers almost.
Okay, so is you don't want catamaran because of the width restriction or some other reason?
Mainly you can't use for the sea services.
Why not? In CAT, all their ferries are catamaran from Tasmania too. So the only issue one would think of catamaran in a sea is because it is overstable, hence it is stiff. So people may feel, because it's more stable, you feel uncomfortable, as you know, as a mariner, you know, right? So stability and comfort are opposite things. So you can always force, in the sense, reduce that margin of stability to achieve the comfort also. It's a possibility, I'm saying. So we can do single hull also. I'm not saying we can't do, but I just want to understand why you are thinking that way. Because if you want margin of stability, you know, passenger ferries, you invariably want to think of margin of stability. It might be better to go in catamaran, but if you insist on single, of course we can do this. It's not an issue.
If there is a sea wave height is 1.5 to 2 meters normally, we generally have a thing. Is it possible to operate such catamarans?
Yeah, of course. The one we are doing in Mumbai, the Mazagon, the Ministry of Defense project, is a high-speed catamaran, 12 knots, 15-meter boat. So that is it's designed for Sea State 5.
Okay.
So they ask designed for Sea State 5, we will do it. If you say Sea State 6, we can do it. That's not a.
Huh? And what about the. What about the hull construction material? Are this a FAPI or are you going for aluminium hull?
You can do either. We have both works for solar electric. Once you talk solar electric renewable, don't do steel and wood. Do aluminium or FRP. FRP will be cheaper and easier maintenance. Aluminium is a good idea on a seagoing vessel where you have an impact load. Otherwise, FRP is the most cost effective. We can do aluminium as well.
Okay. So that means in rough condition, if we go for FRP also, we can...
Yes. So FRP can be as strong as steel.
Okay.
It is the only disadvantage of FRP is if you have an impact load like a sharp metal object puncturing it. So it will not bend like aluminium. It will just puncture. But then you have multiple compartments anyway for like damage stability, we do for two compartments, strength requirement.
Okay, definitely. We will be in touch with you so that we have some project for Baipur and Calicut.
Yeah,
thank you.
Absolutely.
Sandeep, from my order to delivery, what is the timeline?
So 6 months for a typical boat. If some complex stuff is coming in, as in which is more regulatory, then it could be as much as 8 to 9 months. If it's a totally new kind of system and all, some 8 to 9. That's typically the maximum.
Where is your yard? Considering yard? Where is
in Alappuzha. In Alappuzha.
Yeah. Sadit, nice to hear you here in CMA. CMA.
Thank you.
Hi, Sadit. I just have a few doubts. It's a doubt. Yes, see, sir. Do you have these panels? You get specialized panels, or is it available in India, or you import it?
For our kind of applications, what you're talking, marine application, but it's anyway not full time in the sea. So it has salt exposure, but so that there are panels available in India who meets those standards of salt, mist, and all. So you choose those panels, which you do on solar insulation on the beach side. I mean, if you are on a house and all, if you do, you choose those panels, right? On a beach side, on a mountain, you may not do, but on a beach side, you similar panels you have to choose. There are special panels for installing on a sailboat, for example. Right?
Okay.
They are at least 4 to 5 times more expensive. Okay. On a specific case, that also can be done. But typically, these boats, the normal panels are sufficient. It lasts. I mean, we have seen Aditya, it's 5 years now already. So we think, although the panels are meant for 20, 25 years, we think 10 years.
Okay.
Why we think 10 years is at the 10th year, it might be more effective to replace a panel than let it run on the board for another 10 years.
Okay.
Because the efficiencies would have changed. I mean, already when we did Aditya, it was around 18%. Now it's 20%. So when in another 5 years, I think it might be 22 to 25%. Then you might be better off replacing the panel with the same area is okay. My estimate.
One more thing, because I was thinking about, since you were talking about fishing boards, because of the technology and the materials that use, it can be only new fishing boards that can be solar. But see, that will be depending upon somebody who's going for new. I was thinking about the possibility of converting the existing. Is there any chance you can convert the existing fishing boards into a solar? Will the machine and the weight will... Is there a possibility? Then there's a huge, larger scope for this.
No, so I understand because there are already 2.5 lakh fishing boards, at least the small ones.
Yeah.
Clearly, conversion is the best. But unfortunately, you know the situation in the industry, right? Boats are, boat building is a fragmented industry. It's not like cars, right? So which means every place is a smaller person who's making it. So no time or effort spent in design, optimization, choice of material. It's a very heavy boat. We have done a conversion already in Gujarat. We did about 4 or 5 years back on the fishing boat, on a small fishing boat. It's super heavy. So we can do, but the break even then shifts another 2 years. Right?
Okay,
so
okay.
It's a choice whether you want to do on a heavy boat or not. So we are not saying we cannot do. We can do, but the economics may work out slightly differently.
Okay. Is the registration procedures for your fishing boards, these solar boards and the other boards the same? And as Mr. Jabba was talking about, whether you are eligible for any carbon credits on this?
So carbon credit answer is yes. It will come to the final owner. Whoever is the owner of the board, carbon credit is...
How it is based on the times, based on the hours played, or how it is?
So it is, so since it's a shift from one system to another, no? So it's a question of convincing them with the documentation and other things, like a typical diesel boat would be consuming so much. In our case, we have all the documentary evidences and IEEE papers and all to establish that difference of this 30 lakh equivalent, which is about 35,000 liters per year for a ferry boat, I'm saying. That is an easy to establish and can get. The carbon credit process is now it has started becoming a bit more easier. So now they are trying to get it done, as in for the water transport, we are trying to help them do. But earlier it was not done. And that was also a time when the carbon credit value was crashed.
You
remember a time when it really very bad. Now it's slowly better off. So that's with the carbon credit. And
no, it can be tradable, exchange tradable instrument, isn't it?
Correct. So that value of doing that is now emerging. Regarding the regulatory thing, of course, all the regulatory requirements of a public transport we have to meet if it's a ferry boat. So our boats are IRS class, all the class standards approvals are there, which is why it took time 2017 to get first solar ferry for public transport. So it took so long. Although solar boats have been there from 1990s onwards, it was there. So regulatory part is fishing boat also, it's nothing to do with solar or petrol. There is a standard regulation for safety, stability, etc. We have to follow that. But on public transport, the propulsion system has a lot of additional standards, right? Much more than in EV. This is why it took us almost 2 years for us for the first boat. It took a lot of time to get the regulatory requirements. And also there are no rules in place in India. That was very interesting. I mean, the rules came in after we built the boat. So we were referring to the DNV rules, Norwegian rules, and then convincing them to approve basis that. And now last year, the rules have finally come in place, at least as a guidelines document.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Sadit.
Thank you.
Sadit, that's another question from our secretary, Sina. I think Honorable Mayor has joined, so we will conclude this. Sandeep, the question is, can we have external floating panel for small boats sailing in sea to meet a part of energy requirements? Is that a possibility?
And so the boat is standing and you have a panels on a floating thing, or boat is moving and having.
It'll be like in seas, inside the sea, maybe the floating, there are flexible solar panels are available. So can we have something merging with this and apply it?
So if you are, so the transfer from any location to the boat, the challenge is either you have the boat stationary at the time during transfer if there is no storage, or you have the storage on that floating thing and then transferring when you are close to that, right? So in the case of the latter, which is there is a storage, then the cost becomes too high. So which is why from a shore, we take from a grid only. We don't keep a battery on the shore to generate and store, because the battery itself is the most expensive element. But if you are thinking of a scenario where for some reason boat is stationary in the sea and there you have a floating solar producing, yeah, it might work.
Okay. So I think, thanks a lot, Sandeep. Thank you very much for joining Calicut Mineral Association and sharing your long sort of a vision on and waterways. We have our honorable mayor joined us. So I think I will go ahead and invite our Colonel Nisar Ahmed Sethi, Managing Committee Member, to introduce our chief guest, Dr. Beena Philip. Over to you, Colonel.
A true leader leads by personal example for others to follow. A wonderful and great evening, and may peace be upon all of you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a true leader amidst us today evening. Dr. Beena Philip, our Calicut Corporation Mayor, who is dearly known as Beena Teacher. Elected from the Potemmel Ward last year in December, and she is the fourth woman mayor of Kozhikode Corporation. So that itself shows the empowerment of women in the present society.
Colonel, you're muted. Please unmute, Colonel.
Yes.
Am I? Can you hear me now?
Yes, please.
I think there was a little issue as far as the net was concerned. My apologies.
Last 2 seconds.
So, as the principal of Nadakkal Higher Secondary Vocational Government School, that PRISM, that great project, which has changed the overall view of government schools, and she has done a wonderful job of bringing up that school as a benchmark for other schools to emulate. And she was also the principal of Government Higher Secondary School, Archivattam. And in a just about 6 months plus of tenure as the mayor of Kozhikode Corporation, I think she has already set a foot for others to see the difference. Because that humbleness and that teacher's quality of listening to people more than preaching, that is something I salute you, ma'am. And you have taken care with that empathetic view of the weaker and the needy sections of our society. I can go on and on, but your hectic schedule doesn't permit me, so that you can highlight and enlighten us today evening. So may I request all of you to kindly welcome our dear Beena Teacher with a warm applause. Now the stage is all yours, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Colonel. Before Mayor, I would, our President would like to, take 2 minutes to thank our guest, Mayor Dr. Beena Philip, President.
Thank you, Anil. Madam, very, very warm good evening to you. I know that we are all very busy with the schedule, tight schedules. Still, we were eagerly waiting for you. As you know, Calicut Management Association is one of the most vibrant local management association in India. Calicut Management Association got best LMA award 4 times, initially in 96-97 and last 2017-18 and 18-19. We are conducting now, this next year is our Silver Jubilee year. We are directly conducting so many programs every year, especially our next Shaping the Young Minds program in All India level is coming up in next month on August 25th. Every month we conduct a speaker session. Today is our festival on
Captain, we can't hear you, Captain, properly.
Captain, your audio is gone.
Yes, Captain, please go ahead.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Okay, we had 2 sessions today morning. One was on waste management, another one is on energy management. We have done 2 wonderful sessions, which actually we were wishing you to join and pass your comments. Anyhow, it's still late hours, you have joined with us. Once again, thank you. Please go ahead with your talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Captain Haridas. With an apology, I'll start my speech. I'm so happy that CMA is conducting this kind of online programs on energy and environment management. And 2 wonderful speakers you might have had, though I missed the chance, on sustainable and scientific waste management and renewable energy in marine transport. As a mayor of Kozhikode, I would like to, about environment and energy, I would like to say our concern over managing plastic and other waste, or rather solid waste. So that's our main concern now. We all, cried a lot about Neliyan Parambu, and those who have lived here in the 70s and 80s might remember the kind of trucks that passed in front of our vehicles, causing our hands to go touch our nose. I don't want to elaborate upon that. Now that plight is over. Even when we pass through that national highway, we don't even get that stinky smell, stink, which we had 20 years back. Then we have produced the Kudumbashree is collecting the bio waste and it's been converted into manure, which we sell for a price. That's what we do. And we are eagerly expecting for another plant which can convert all our solid waste as well as bio waste into energy. That's what we are waiting for. But we are also anxious about its success, because we hear from different sources that such plants are not running for a longer period due to many, many, many reasons. So now what we face is converting plastic into something productive, or into that we can shred it and make pellets, and pellets can be transported to some other place in the factories. That's what we are doing at West Hill. Even then we have our regard on how to manage the plastic waste in the corporation. That's what we are concerned about, and hope those who are listening me in this platform, on this platform, they may be able to guide the corporation with their suggestions. Taking decisions at corporation level is very difficult, as you all know. Not red tape, in fact. It's a kind of democratic functioning which is causing the delay. We have to discuss at different committees, and then we have to take a decision. We have to think of the funds. These are the obstructions before us when we think of a viable plant which can convert all our solid waste into something productive or something useful. That's what we face right now. Even now, some of you who are living in Kozhikode Corporation area, especially in the town area, might have seen so many sacks, dumped into the empty spaces on the roadside. That's a pity. Because when the contractor withdraw without satisfying all the conditions, we find it very difficult. You cannot simply run after that person with a truck of policemen and arrest him and put him in jail. That won't solve the problem. So that's the way we suffer a lot. people who come to me promise so many, promise that they would maintain that area clean. Even when they leave, they promise that they will clean all that space. But still, when they leave, they don't do anything. In spite, many other agencies put all their waste into that corners where we have especially assigned for a particular agency. This is what we find. So what I, as a mayor, feel that we have to seek smaller units where we can convert the solid waste into something productive or useful or whatever it is. Smaller units instead of a large unit, if it stops, the whole city sinks. So before that, if there are smaller units in different parts of the corporation, if one unit is stuck, then we can move to the other unit at least. So this is the only solution that comes to my mind, which is an old mind, but still my eyes are open to the whole world sometimes. So that's what I find. If anybody in this group who can give suggestions for Food Corporation, who knows the place, who knows the culture of the people, then you're all welcome. And coming to CMA need not be on this particular platform on this particular day. Feel when you find some other solutions, you're always welcome to meet the people, the mayor and the different committee chairman, and we can discuss your solutions or from your side. That's what I find, because people think differently. People know different sources, different agencies, different places where things are moving somewhat smoothly. For me, Japanese companies, because they are the most densely populated area, they do have, being a small island and thickly populated, they might have thought of these small units. And their technology is somewhat, lower cost, or we can't say cheaper, it's a derogatory sense. Their cost may be less compared to the other agencies' cost of the plants or something. And in Germany also, they have different proposals because their country was also a small country and they are very perfect. Their machinery will be very perfect. But only thing is their weather climate conditions are different from ours. That is the main problem. And whenever we start something in a humid place like Kozhikode, the machines that we import from other countries may not work as smoothly as they expect or as we expect. That are the conditions. So you, if at all you have any kind of suggestions, you're all welcome. Through mail, email, you can send to the mayorkozhikode@gmail.com or through WhatsApp in this number, which I'm using right now as the mayor's official number. Your suggestions are welcome. And once again, whenever IMA conduct a program, I don't know how it happened. Somehow, I can't enter into your group in the prescribed time. I'm very sorry about it. You can see the official background. So you might have sent the people speaking to me as they leave my office since I have to enter into this online program. So, at this time of the hour, that is at about 8 o'clock in the night, the mayor is sitting here in her office, thinking, planning, and discussing with a lot of issues that we face these days. Mainly, it is COVID. Even then, we have to think of equally important is waste management. People used to say that municipalities, you might have seen that movie, Satyameva Jayate. In that, it is seen how the people's representative, the bureaucrats, and the so-called, in quotation, social workers, how they live on parasites on the issue of waste management. But here in Kozhikode, tell you frankly, we have not yet talked like that. So far, whatever we have done is with a clean heart and with a visionary mind. Even now, we are waiting for another plant which has been initiated by the Kerala government. And we, the corporation, are the second party to it. So that is why, I always hope that this should be a grand success in Kerala, in Kozhikode, especially in Kerala, being the first of its kind, and it should fulfill its aim, its purpose. That's what I hope for. Even then, you cannot wait for 2 or 3 years for that plant to be complete. In between, we have to think of the alternative. So my dear friends, as alternatives, you can have suggestions. You can even have, if at all you have any experience, you can go to the note, you can come here, go to the notice of our, bring it to the notice of ours, so that we all can think and we can act as early as possible. Of course, smaller units. If at all any company is ready to give us a free plant as a pilot project, you know, it's also welcome, so that we need not spend much. You all know the plight of all the institutions, how we suffered due to COVID. Our own fund is going down, it's running out, in fact. So we have to think of something very highly economical to our corporation. And at the same time, if anybody is willing to start something new, like JECA, a Japanese company, what they have, they did a number of years ago, and some other agency who can stand one plant, you can make one plant here, provided we give them area for that. That can be a model, and many other panchayats and municipalities and even the other states can follow suit. So that way also, your information, your connections, your goodwill, all should think of a way for us, the Kozhikode Corporation, to solve the problem of waste management. And for waste management, we pump out a lot of money and energy. Energy in a different sense. Energy of each human being. Like a mayor, like you people sitting here discussing energy. Think of the human energy that we spent on, you know, devising plans and solutions for all our problems regarding plastic waste and other solid waste. That's what I would love to share with you, dear friends. And thank you very much for inviting me for this platform. Though I came late, I'm sure you all will forgive me for not keeping time. As you all know, how hectic my days are. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mayor. We are delighted to let you know that we have got two eminent persons who specialize in the waste management today in the call. One, Dr. Reena Anil Kumar, who happens to be a managing committee member and a vice president in CMA. And she has been working on waste management for more than two decades, working with Kerala government in multiple levels. Another young entrepreneur, Jabir Karat, who had presented and talked about waste management and his initiatives in Kozhikode, Kerala, and outside Kerala. So two of them are there readily available in the call today. I mean, probably we can invite them to, you know, give a brief or, you know, talk to Mayor. Can I invite Madam Dr. Reena?
Yeah, definitely. I do welcome them to Kozhikode Corporation. Whichever date is convenient for them, I will make somehow make myself available and my team too.
All right, thank you very much. Dr. Reena, are you there? Okay, by the time Reena joins, Jabir?
Thanks, ma'am. Actually, very, very happy to hear you. And we have been working, you know, because still we manage more than 20 hospitals, the dry waste management, the solid waste from the city and biomedical. And we had some bad experience with the corporations. So we moved out of the corporations and working with other 25 villages. So working with officials and all, we found it a little, you know, unwelcoming for young entrepreneurs. So we just moved out of corporation, but still we do have an office in Calicut, and we collect only from, you know, we used to collect from apartments, commercial establishments, and residents' welfare associations. We were the partner for the NDA card projects. So we were the implementation partner. So we have tried many things. So it's so I was saying, you know, we are very happy, you know, if you give us a chance, you know, at least as a pilot, maybe 1,000 households or 2,000 households, you know, maybe 3 to 6 months time. You don't need to give us land. You don't need to give us any money. You know, we have a real good model, you know, we have own space, we have own facilities, we have all infrastructure. So I'm so happy that you are, you know, I will come and meet you. And so we can share in details and we can share you how we have done other places. Thank you. Looking forward to it.
Oh, thanks, I'm so happy that at this particular moment itself, one helping hand is extending towards me, or rather I am my hand that I have extended towards you who's been responded. Thank you very much. Am I speaking to Mr. Karat?
Yes.
Yeah, I saw your photograph on that invitation. I just had a glance of it. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Karat.
So also we have Dr. Reena Anil Kumar. Yes, ma'am. So also we had Dr. Reena Anil Kumar. I'm not sure if she's hearing me, but she's part of Calicut Management Association, and we will come back to you in terms of what we can do jointly. So if you look at Calicut Management Association, we work with our honorary district collector, commissioner, and other institutions to provide management bandwidth and help in terms of planning, in terms of any sort of, whether in training, any sort of management help that Calicut Management Association can give to the government organization. So we work very closely with that. So we would love to come to you and say whatever best we can do from our perspective. Can I request any other questions, please, for our honorable mayor? I know that it's too late. Maybe one or two questions, and we will be really grateful for you, mayor, if you could answer. Anybody wants to ask a question, please?
Everybody wants to go for the dinner, I'm sure. I'm very hungry. Really hungry.
Okay.
Now.
President, please, last question.
Madam, whenever you conduct any meetings or conduct NGOs or other organizations, you can please invite us also. We were there, okay. We involved with Riviatan also. So we are ready to give any sort of consultancy advice, and we have support of IIM, NIT and all. So we'll definitely, we are happy to give any support to corporation.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I would request Secretary Mr. Srinath to deliver the vote of thanks.
Hi, CMA. On behalf of CMA, I'm thankful to Honorable Mayor Kozhikode, to Dr. Bina Philip for his talk. Thank you so much, madam, for sharing your thoughts, and definitely CMA would like to be a part of your endeavor in the coming days. Thank you. We will meet up directly and put maximum suggestions so that you can run it much more in a better way. Thank you.
Thank you.
And also thank you to Mr. Jabir Karet, for founder of Green Work, and his presentation is very thoughtful. We can adopt a lot of actions out of that. Thank you, Karet, once again on behalf of CMA. And lastly, I thank your Sandeep Tadasheri, founder of Navit Solar Systems. Thank you so much for your wonderful presentation. It's a big insight for us in terms of, we are really surprised how a boat, a huge boat like this, can work in a solar environment. I'm so really happy to know its real potential. Hopefully, it can work in a better way in the future. All the best for that. And finally, on behalf of CMA, I'm thankful to all the members of CMA. I'm also thanking Colonel Nessa for the wonderful introduction, Anil Balan for its coordination, and all of us, thank you once again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Ma'am, Sandeep is another entrepreneur from Kochi who is doing a very innovation in terms of solar, running a boat using solar energy. So he has done a wonderful stuff, and a lot of appreciation from Government of India and Kerala. Probably, Sandeep, you should visit Mayor also to look at if any possibilities in Baipur that we can do, from a waterways perspective, along with our Captain K.K. Haridas.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Good night. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Anil. It was a wonderful
session.
Thanks
a lot. Yeah. Thank you. Thank
Sandeep,
you very much.
Thank you.
Signing out.
Thank you very much.
Jabir.
Actually, madam was very much busy with the traders.
Yeah.
That's why I'm in the cabin.
ഒരു രക്ഷയിൽ ഒടുവിൽ ഞാൻ പി എ